Hello everyone, in this video we will be solving NTA UGC NET question paper. If you like this video, please like, share and subscribe. It takes lot of effort to create videos like this, so this is a small contribution required from your side so that it motivates us to go do better. If you want to download the presentation or PPT that we have used in this video, then you can go to our website, which is www.digimentor.com, and you can also visit our courses section to check out our comprehensive courses for GATE, UGC NET, placement preparation and PGT examinations. You can also chat with our chat representative on the website for complete information regarding the courses. So let us start with the following video.
Now question number 6 is, the octet number is 326.4 and you have to tell the equivalent decimal and hexadecimal number. Now 326.4. So first convert, this is octal number, base is 8. Now we have to convert it in a decimal form. So for decimal is, so this is 6, 8 is power 4, 2 into 8 raised to power 1 plus 2 in 3 into 8 raised to power 2. Now this is 4 into, and after the decimal right hand side you take minus value, so this is 8 raised to power minus 1. Now this is 3 into 8 is a 64 plus 8 to the 16 plus this is 8 raised to power 0 is 1 and this is 6 plus 4 into 1 by 8. Now this will become 92 plus 16 plus 6 plus 1 by 2. Now after solving this you got 4 to 9 by 2, okay, and if you divide this by 2 you got 214.5 and the base is 10 because this is a decimal form, right? Now convert it into a hexadecimal form also. So for hexadecimal, each bit represented by, each number is represented by 4 bits. So first convert this octal number into a binary form and then convert it into a decimal. Okay, you know that in a octal number each number is represented by 3 bits because 2 raised to power 3 is 8. Now 3 bits represent one number, so 6 is going to be represent with 3 bits. So this is going to be like this. This is 6. How are you going to represent 2 with the help of 3 bits? Like this. And 3 is 0, 1, 1. And this is point and 4 is 1, 0, 0. And you know that in a hexadecimal, the base is 16. So we are using 4 bits to represent hexadecimal number. So you have to start from here and make the grouping of 4 bits, 1 2 3 4 bits, and if not, if sufficient number of bits are not there, so just append that number of bits. Now you write, you group from, you know, from this, if this is a decimal number, grouping are going from left, right to left, and if at the right hand side of the decimal, grouping is going from left to right. So I'm going to append one more zero so that I can make the group of 4 bits. So this will become 4 plus 2 is 6. This is 8 plus 4 is 12 plus 1 is 13. So 13 in hexadecimal form is D. And this is 4 zero means 0 only. So there's no need to write this. And decimal is there, point is there, and this has become 8. So the hexadecimal form is D6.8 and the base is 16. So the correct answer is option 3. Now question number 5 is, given the following graph, so there is a one graph G1 and there is a one graph is G2. Which of the following is correct? So they are talking about the Euler circuit. You have to find it out that the following in G1 and G2, which one is Euler circuit. So let's talk about Euler graph first. So the Euler graph, in the Euler graph we studied two things, the Euler path and the Euler circuit. There is a difference, there is a big difference between the Euler path and Euler circuit. As the in the Euler circuit, you have to traverse the, you can say that this graph, you have to traverse this graph, visit every edge exactly once. You are not allowed to repeat the edge which is present in this graph more than once. So you have to take care of this. You have in the Euler graph, while traversing this whole graph, you have to visit each edge at one time only. At one time only. So let's take the example for Euler path. So if this is a graph, and you have to traverse this whole graph, but take care of that, you have to visit each edge at one time only. You can repeat the vertices, but you cannot repeat the edges. So if I traverse here, I visit this edge. Now I visit this edge. Now I visit this edge, and this edge. Okay, so I start from here and I end my journey here, and I, you know, traverse each edge which is present in the graph. So this is the Euler path. And if we talk about this Euler circuit, in the Euler circuit, the starting point should be equal to the end point. It means that जहाँ से आपने start किया है visit करना अपने graph को, वहीं पर आप end करोगे. So you can see that this is not a Euler circuit, because हमने start यहाँ किया था और हमने end कहाँ पर किया, यहाँ पर. So this is not a Euler circuit, this is a Euler path. So this is, if I draw like this, now this is a Euler path and this is also a Euler circuit. So if I start from here, I visit this edge, then 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 I visit this edge, and then I visit this edge, and I reached at the same point from where I start my journey. So this is also a Euler circuit, and this is also a Euler path. Okay, so what is the necessary condition so that the, you know, any graph is a Euler circuit? So write it down, this is important. Necessary condition for Euler circuit. Please make note for this, because it is very important. Necessary condition for Euler circuit is degree of every vertex. Degree of every vertex in a graph should be even. This is a necessary condition. So please make note of this. I'm highlighting this point. Degree of every vertex in a graph should be even. Okay, if this condition not going to, you know, hold, then in that case it may happen that that particular graph is Euler path, will contain the Euler path, but it is not a Euler circuit. You can see in this graph the degree is 1, 2, 3, the number of edges which are associated with this vertex. So degree is 3. Here the degree is 2, here is the degree of is 3, here the degree is 2. So the odd number of, you know, degrees also present in this graph. That's why this is not a Euler circuit, but it is a Euler path. It may be, it may be happen that some graph is Euler, contain the Euler path, but it is not a Euler circuit. Now let's take this graph. This graph is Euler circuit also and Euler path also. So the every node should contain the even number of degree. So the degree of this vertex is 4, degree of this vertex is 2, degree of this vertex is 4, degree of this vertex is 2. So all the nodes contain the even degree, that's why it is a Euler circuit. As well as if this is Euler circuit, then it is a Euler path. But if it is a Euler path is present, it is not it's always possible that it also contain a Euler circuit. Now after knowing this condition, ab is question ko solve karna is very easy. Now you know that agar kisi graph mein agar kis ek bhi vertex ki agar degree odd hai, then you can say that this is not a Euler circuit. Now start from this graph. So the degree of this vertex is 3, so it is a odd degree. You can say that this is not a Euler circuit. Now the degree of this vertex is 3, so this is an odd degree, so you can say that this is not a Euler circuit. It's very easy. Now so both g1 and g2 do not contain Euler circuit. They are not talking about the Euler path, they are talking about Euler circuit. For Euler circuit, this condition is a necessary condition. Okay, so it's very easy. Now question number 4 is, what is the probability that a randomly selected bit string of length 10 is a palindrome? Now first I'm going to tell you what is palindrome. So palindrome is, let's suppose some values is like this. So if you read from left hand side or you read from the right hand side, the value remains same. So if you read from here, this is 100, right? This is 100. And if you read from here, from right hand side, this is 100. This is also 100. So when you read from left hand side or either from right hand side, the value remains same. So this is a palindrome. So they are talking about the length 10 means it is a even palindrome. They are talking about the even palindromes. So how many numbers are present? 10. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and 10. And you know that if this is a palindrome, it means that these five values are equal to the these five values. Okay, so first five values are exactly same as of the last five values. Okay, now so they are talking about the bit string. It means either they contain 0 or 1, 2 values. Okay, so to place any value, we have two choices. Either we place 0 or either we place 1. So two choices here. Two choice here. Either we place 0 or either we place 1. Two choice, two and two. So these are the choices. Either we fill these spaces either with 0 or with 1. Now, what is the probability that a randomly selected bit string of length m is a palindrome? So if this is a palindrome, these 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, right? So these 5 are same with these last 5 values, right? So now you can write it down like the total sample space is how many number of space are there. 10 values are there, so 10, and each 10 value, 10 spaces, you can say 10 spaces have two choices. Either they fill this space with 0 or 1. So 2^10 is the total sample space. And for palindrome, if we choose first 5 bits, if we choose first 5 bits, so these bits if we choose first 5 bits, then you can say that the last 5 bits are fixed. Because if we choose like, if this at this place is 1 1 0 0 0, right? So the last space, the last 5 boxes are fixed, so they contain like this 1 1 0 0 0. That's why it makes one palindrome, huh? So if we choose first 5 bits, then last remaining 5 bits will be fixed, right? Will be fixed. So the required probability is, so this is 2 raised to power 5, because 5 spaces are there and we have 2 choices, and the total sample space is 2 raised to power 10, so it will become 2 raised to power 5, and 2 raised to power 5 is 1 by 32. So 1 by 32 is the answer. Okay. Now question number 3 is, let A and B sets in a finite universal set U given the following. So which of the following is an order of increasing size? The best method to solve this kind of question is to take the example. Now the universal set contains some values, some random values like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Set A contains some values like 1, 2, 4, 6, 7. And B also contains some random values like 3, 5, 6, and 7. Now, this is A difference B. A minus B cardinality is how much? A minus B means the elements which is present in B, the elements which is present in B minus with this element, and the left elements is the cardinality of this A minus B. Now 3, 5, 6, 7 is there. So 6 and 7 is also present in B. So we delete this. And how many number of elements which is present now? 1, 2, 3. Okay. So 3 is the cardinality of A minus B, of the set difference operation. Now this is our. Now the next one is A XOR B cardinality is how much? A XOR B means the element which is either present in A but not in B, or present in B but not in A. Now the elements which is present in A but not in B is 1, 2 and 3. So these are the elements 1, 2, 4 only, right? And plus the number of elements which is present in B but not in A is 3 and 5. 3 and 5. Now the cardinality of this is 3 plus 2. So 3 plus 2 is 5. Okay. Now the next one is cardinality of A plus cardinality of B. Now the cardinality of A is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Plus cardinality of B is 1, 2, 3, 4. So the total is 9. Now the next one is A union B. So you have to write those elements which is present in both, but you are not allowed to repeat the elements. So the elements like 1, the numbers 1, 2, 3 is present, 4 is present, 5 is present, 6 and 7. 6 and 7 is in the A element, is in A set also and B set also. You have to write it at one time only. So the cardinality of this is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Now just arrange it according to the cardinality. So the maximum cardinality is A plus B, right? So this is the maximum cardinality. Now A union B is the next cardinality, which is smaller than this one. A minus B is 3, and A XOR B. So this is not correct. So this 9, this is 7, XOR key 5, and the A minus with the set difference cardinality is 3. So 3, 5, 7, 9 is the, so this is the, you know, correct order. So with the help of some example, you can, you know, or you can calculate which order is the right one. So option 4 is the right one. Now question number 2 is, let assume that you construct order tree to represent the compound proposition. So this is a compound proposition. Then the prefix expression and the postfix expression determined using this order tree are given as. So first we construct the order tree and then we will find the prefix and the postfix expression, right? So now the this is the compound proposition and this is the left subtree and this is the right subtree for this. So in root node is this, then this is a negation, the whole negation. So we negation is the root node, and then there is an AND operation between P and Q, right? And P is the left child and Q is the right child. Now in between these two, what is the operation OR operation? Then there is a negation of P, right? So negation, and P is the left child. In the same way, negation is here and this is the Q. Okay, now we have to write the prefix expression with the help of this order tree. You know that when we write the prefix, so first we, when we traverse this order tree, then first we print root, then we print left child, and then we print the right child. Okay, so this is it about root, about prefix expression. Now traverse. So if it we start traversing from here, from this is root, this is left subtree, and this is the right subtree. Then when we traverse from here, so first we have to print root. So the root is this biconditional symbol. Now we are here, so first we have to print root, then go to left. So the root is negation, then again we traverse here, then this is a root, so we print it, then we traverse the left subtree and this is also a root because no child is here, so this is root P, and we traverse here, so this is already printed, then Q because root node is printed, all the left child are printed, then we print right subtree, right? So this is right child. Now this is over, this is also over, and this is also over. Now root node is completed, printed, left subtree is printed, now we print the right subtree. Okay, now we are here. Now see, this node is a root node, so we are going to print it, then we going to the left side, left subtree. So this is a root node, so I'm going to print it. Now again I'm going to left subtree, so this is a root node, that's why I'm going to print it. Now I'm coming back, this is already printed, this is already printed, now root is printed, all the left subtree is printed, now I'm going to right subtree. So this is a root node, that's why I'm printing it. Then this is a root node, that's why I'm printing it. Why this is a root node? Because no left child, so this is a root node. For this Q, this is a root node. For this is the root node. Now, so this is completed. Now I'm coming back. This is printed, 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 this is printed. So this is over now. Okay, now you can see that for prefix expression, if you want to print it, the prefix expression with the help of this ordered tree, then you have to remember, you have to first print root, then you have to traverse left subtree and then go to the right subtree. So this is a root, so I'm printing print this, then going to the left subtree. So this is the left subtree and this is the right subtree, and with the help of this notation we are able to print the whole prefix expression. Now let's write the postfix expression also. So the notation is, for postfix, first go to the left child, then print the right child, and then after doing this print root node. Okay, now let's start. So we are start from here. First go to the left subtree, so we are not going to print it root. So I'm here now, so this is a root node. Then going to left, so I'm here now, so I'm going to the left stream left, so this is the left, so no child is here, so this is it, right? So there is no child, right? So just write like this. So nothing is here, so we traverse here, no child, no, nothing is printed. Right child also, nothing is printed. Then we print P. Okay, I'm just changing the color so that you can differentiate between prefix and postfix. Okay, now so P is here, so we print P. Now traverse here, so this is root node, so we are not going to print root node because first we print the left, then we print right, then we print root. So at third time, when we, you know, in a prefix, when we when we visit this root node first time, we print it. But in the postfix expression, when we visit this particular root node or any root, any node, a third time, right? This is a root node, right? So first we visit this root node here, then we visit this root node here, and at the last we are, you know, last time we are visiting this root node here. So when we visit any node last time, then we going to print it in the postfix expression. You can write, you can see that num here, so this is P, no child, so we are going to print this P. After this we are not able to visit this node again, so we print here. Now so this is root node, so we are not going to print it because when we traverse this is the last time where we are going to visit it. So we are at here, so no left child, no right child, so that's why we are print now Q root node. Okay, now left child is finished, right child is finished. Now we are going to print root node. Then we are here, left is finished, right is finished, then we are going to print root node. This is negation. Now left subtree is finished, now we are going to the right subtree, then we print the root. Left, right, root. So I'm here, left child is present, so that's why I'm not going to print it. I'm here, I'm traverse here, so left child is present, so this is a root node, no left child, no right child, that's why I just directly print the root node. Now so left child is finished, right child is not there, so we print node, root node. Now I'm here, left subtree is finished, now I'm going to traverse right subtree, then I'm going to print this root node. So I'm at here, left child is there, so I'm going to print here, no left child, no right child, that's why I print this Q. So now I'm at here, so no left, right child, left child is already printed, that's why I'm going to print root node. Now I'm at here, left subtree is printed, right subtree is printed, now I'm at here, so I'm going to print root. Left subtree is finished, right subtree is finished, that's why I'm going to print this root node. Okay, so just match these two with this options. So correct option is option 2. Hello everyone, welcome to the gatelectures.com. So in today's session I'm going to solve UGCNet previous year paper August 2016 and this is a paper number 2. Now let's start. The question number 1 is the Boolean function. So this is a Boolean function and you have to minimize this Boolean function and then you have to calculate what is the minimum form of this Boolean function. Okay, so you have to minimize it. Now the first step is to solve this kind of question is, you know, to write this Boolean function in a minimal form. How? This is P and Q. You know that, and this is an and this is an or and this is a negation. So how we write this and is with the help of dot, and how we are going to write this or, this is and, this is or, sorry, so this is or and this is not. So or we write it with the help of plus sign and this is not, and we call as a negation and we write it like, you know, bar complement on some variable, right? Now see, so we write it with this help of these symbols, not with these symbols, that so because they are equivalent to each other, so we can write it with this or with this, right? Now this is negation P, so we, the negation sign is this also, so this is a complement and is represented with dot and this is Q. Now you can write it down like this, and this is a bracket and this is negation, means the whole complement like this. Now this is an and, so dot is here again, there is a symbol P, negation of P, and then or, it means sorry, this is n, and this is Q, and the negation of Q is complement and the whole complement also, so this is a whole complement. Now this is a or sign, so I'm writing plus here, and this is P and R, means P dot R. Now solve this. So just expand this complement. How we are going to do that? With the help of De Morgan's law. De Morgan's law. So with the help of De Morgan's law, we can write it down like P complement, the whole complement. So if the sign is, the AND operation is there, then when we expand this with the help of De Morgan's law, so it converted into a OR sign. That's why I write plus. Now Q complement. Okay, now see, it's same here, apply De Morgan's law, so P complement complement, so this sign is converted into OR sign and this is Q complement complement plus P and R. Now this will become P and this will become Q complement. Now this will become P and this will become Q, okay, and this is P into R. Now you know, multiply these two, so P into P is P, P into Q is PQ, Q bar into P is P, Q bar and Q bar into Q is nothing, so it's cancelled. Now this is P into R, means P and R, not into, it's I, this dot represent the AND operation between them. Now you can take P common from this and from this. What is left? 1 is left, then Q is left, Q bar is left and R is left. So 1 plus something is 1 only, so we are left with P only. Okay, so correct answer is 4. Question number 23 is, The runtime for traversing all the nodes of a binary search tree with n nodes and printing them in an order is, okay? So you have one binary search tree and in which n nodes are there, and when you want to print all the nodes, so what is the time complexity when you traverse all the nodes, right? So let's suppose there is one binary search tree, right? And let's take some worst case, and in this this binary search tree, whether it's a left skewed tree or it's a binary search tree, right? And whether it's a right skewed tree, let's take worst case, right? Now let's suppose this is a left skewed tree, right? So number of nodes are there, let's suppose number of nodes we take, let's suppose 10, the value of n is 10, and we are considering left skewed tree. It means all the nodes are inclined from the left hand side. The first root node is 10, then tell me the next node, if this is a left skewed tree, the next node should be here. And you know that in the binary search tree, all the nodes which is present at the left hand side should be less than, right, should be less than the root node, and the all the nodes which is present on the right hand side should be greater than or equal to binary search tree. So all the nodes which is present on the left hand side should be less than. So let's suppose the nodes are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. So these are the number of the nodes. Now 9th node should be present here, then 8, then 7, because 7 is less than 8, then 6, then 5, then 4, then 3, then 2, and 1. Okay, so this is a tree and you have to traverse all the nodes of this binary search tree with n nodes means 10 nodes, and you have to tell them that how much time it will take to print each node. Okay, so you are visiting each node and you are going to print it. So you traverse each node and you print it. You traverse each node and print it. So how many number of nodes are there? How many numbers of nodes are there? 10 nodes. So you visit this node 10 and you print it. You visit this node, you print it. You visit this node, you print it. So like this and so on till end point. Okay, so in total how many number of nodes? In our case 10 nodes, so it will take order of 10 time. But if the number of nodes are n, then it will take order of n time. Okay, so the runtime for traversing all the nodes of a binary search tree with n nodes, and you have to print it in them in an order, it will take order of n time. Okay, so option third is the right one. Now question number 24. Consider the following statements. We have two statements are there. Statement number one is a queue can be implemented using two stacks. Okay, so they are saying ki if you have two stacks, then are you able to implement queue with the help of two stacks? And the second statement is, if you have two queues, then with the help of two queues, are you able to implement a stack? So you have to prove whether this these two statements are correct or not. So just check. Okay, now let's take one example, and with the help of example we are going to prove these two statements. Let's take first statement S1. You know that queue follow first in first out, right? Jo pehle aayega, jo bhi element you put into the queue, it should be, you know, go out first. So first in, जो पहले आया वो ही पहले जाएगा. So this is first in, first out. And stack follows last in, first out. जो last आया वो first बाहर निकलेगा. Okay. Now, just remember these two things. Now, so we have two stacks. If we talk about the first statement, so this is the stack number one and this is the stack number two and this is my queue. This is a queue one. Okay, now elements are like A, B, C and D. Now first operate the queue operation. ठीक है, अब queue में insertion is going from, this is the front side and this is the rear side. So हम insertion करते हैं यहाँ से and we are going to delete it from this side. Okay, now insert first element. The first element is A. Okay, now we insert from here, right? So the next element is B. So we push into the queue. Now the next element is C. So we push it. C. And the next element is D. So we push it from the rear end. Okay. Now, after the insertion, we are performing the deletion operation on the queue. Now, so deletion is possible from this side, from the queue. Okay, and queue follows first in, first out. You know that first kon aaya tha? A. So it should be go out first A only, right? So deletion is from this side. I'm writing here. Deletion is, you know, is from this side and the insertion is from this side. This is the rear end and this is the front end of the queue, right? Now, so deletion, A is deleted, A is pop out from the queue. Now the first element which we are going to print is print A. Now the next one is after A is deleted. Now the next one is B. So we delete B. Then we delete C and then we delete D. So this is the order. A, B, C, D. First we print A, then we print B, then we print C, then we print D according to the queue, right? Now we check with the help of two stacks, the order should be this only. Okay, now this is the elements. Okay, now first this element will come, so A push on to into the stack A. Now the top of the stack is this. So insertion is from this side only and deletion bhi yahin se hi hoga. There is only one end. There is no two ends like in a queue, front end and rear end. So in queue mein you have two doors jahan se ek se aap deletion kar rahe ho, dusre se aap deletion insertion kar rahe ho, ek se aap deletion kar rahe ho. But in queue there is only one way. Yahin se aap deletion karoge, yahin se aap on the top of the stack mein insertion is possible. So first is A, then we have to insert B, then insert B, then you have to insert C and then you insert D. Okay, so now tell me what is the order of, you know, you are popping all the elements. If you pop the elements, then first D should be, maine kaha tha ki there is only one end. So the, now the top of the stack is this. Okay. Now deletion is also possible from the top of the stack. So first, which element is deleted? D is deleted because last in, first out. So D last mein aaya, so it should go out first. So D is deleted and I'm going to push this D into this stack. ठीक है? एक बार ही हम देख लेते हैं कि order क्या रहता है अगर हम इस सिर्फ एक ही स्टैक को इम्प्लीमेंट करके हम प्रिंट करवाएं. तो फर्स्ट क्या प्रिंट होगा अकॉर्डिंग टू दिस स्टैक. सो फर्स्ट प्रिंट is D. फिर हम next delete करेंगे C को, then we delete करेंगे B को, and then we delete करेंगे A को. So हमने इनको pop किया, पहले हमने push किया सारे elements को, and there is only one way, top of the stack से ही insertion possible है, top of the stack से ही deletion pop operation possible है. तो first D, C, B, A. So this is the order. Now check, this order is same with this order. So this is the reverse of this order, right? So this is not the same order. That's why we are using the two sticks. Now, so we pop D from this stack and we push it into the stack 2. Okay. So now this is going to be deleted. Now top of the stack points to C. So we delete C now and push it into the stack of S2. Now, the top of the stack pointing to the element B. Now P we are going to pop and push it into the stack. Now we are going to pop A and push it into the stack A. Okay. Now we print it. So print karne ke liye we have to, you know, operate the function operation pop operation. So now the top of the stack is this one and the element present is A. So we pop it A, then we pop B, then we pop C, and then we pop D. Now check, the order is same, the printing order is same in the queue also and the stack also. So you can say that with the help of two stacks we can implement queue. With the help of one stack it is not possible, but yes, with the help of two stacks we can implement the queue. Queue implement karne ka matlab ki jo order first in first out jo humne jo element first aaya wahi first out hua, to ye jo property hai ye bhi fulfill hui with the help of two stacks. So S1 statement is absolutely true. Now let's check statement 2. Okay, now in the statement number 2 you have two queues and one stack, aur aapko kya implement karna hai, with the help of two queues you have to implement stack. Okay, now two queues and number of elements are 4, 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, and this is the queue number 1, and this is the queue number 2, and this is our stack. Okay, now if these are the four elements and you have to, you know, push it into the stack, so first we push 1, then we push 2, then we push 3, and then we push 4. Okay, now top of the stack points to fourth element. Now we are going to operate the pop operation. A pop operation bhi yahin se possible in the stack also. So we pop 4, then we pop 3, then we pop 2, and then we pop 1. So this is the order. Okay, this is a printing order. Now Q, let's take Q. Now in the four elements are there, so I have already told you that this is the front end, this is the rear end. Yahan se deletion hoti hai, yahan se insertion hoti hai, right? So first element is 1, so you are going to push inserted into the queue. Now the next element is 2, so insert 2 into the queue. Third element is 3, insert it into the queue. And the fourth element is 4, so insert it into the queue. Now agar main deletion operation perform karti hu to order kya rahega. Agar main sirf ek queue ko use kar rahi hu to deletion is possible from this side. So first one come out, then 2 will come out, then 3 will come out, and then 4 is going to come out. So this order is not same as this order, so with the help of one queue it's not possible. Let's take another queue also, right? So when deletion operation I applied on the Q1, then delete 1 from this queue, and I'm going to insert this element into this queue, like we did in the stack. We delete the element from this queue and we push it into the stack 2. So in the same way, if I delete 1 from the Q1 and I'm going to insert it in Q2, okay, then the next one is 2 and I'm going to insert it into the Q2, and then I'm going to delete 3 and insert in Q2. Okay, now do not delete 4 and insert in Q2, because I want ki first jo main element ko print karu, it should be 4. Okay, now in this queue, this is deleted, this is deleted, this is deleted, only one element is present, which is 4. So the next one is 4. If I'm going to delete it and directly I'm going to print it, so the first element I'm going to print it is 4. Okay, so 4 is also deleted in this queue. Now the Q1 is empty, right? Now, so deletion, now I'm going to operate deletion operation on the Q2. So Q2 maybe operation is deletion operation is possible from the front end. So first I'm going to delete 1 and I'm going to insert it in Q1. Next time a next element is going to be deleted, it's 2, so I'm going to insert in Q1, and the left one is 3. So when I delete third element, so I'm not going to insert in Q1, I'm just going to directly print it. Okay, so now this queue is going to be empty. Now, so the front end, the first element is 1, so I'm going to delete it and I'm going to insert it in the stack, in the queue, and the left out element is only 2, so I'm going to delete it, but I'm not going to push it or insert it. So this is I'm just directly printed, so this is 2. And if there is only one element which is present here, only 1, so I'm going to delete it and I'm going to print it. Now see, this is the same order we found in the stack. So you can say that with the help of 2 queues, you are easily able to implement stack. So you can say that S1 and S2 both are correct. Okay. Now question number 25. Given the following expression, prefix expression, so this is a prefix expression, what is the value of the prefix expression? Okay, so you have to evaluate this prefix expression. So you know that when you the prefix expression is, when you write the prefix expression, so you first you write root not, then you write left, and then you go to right. So first remember this thing. Okay, prefix means first root, then left side the tree, or then the right subtree. Okay, now so you traverse, if this is a prefix expression, to hame left right to left hame move karna hai. First thing is you have to remember this prefix expression is first root, then left subtree, then right subtree. Second thing is, if this is the prefix expression, you have to move from left, right to left. Okay. Third thing is, we are going to use stack to evaluate this prefix expression, because this is stack application to evaluate the prefix expression. Okay. So we are using the stack for this purpose. If this is a stack, so whenever you find some operands like 3, any number, 3, 4, 5, any number, so you are going to push it into the stack, and whenever you find, while traversing this whole expression from right to left, whenever you find some operation like plus, this power operation, this plus, then plus, then the multiplication, whenever you find any operation, okay, so you are going to pop the operands which is present in the stack and operate the function, operate the this particular operation. Okay, now let's start from the from the right hand side. So first one is the this is the operand, so I'm going to push it into the stack. Okay, so let's move further. Next is also operand, so I'm going to push it into the stack. Now the next one also operand, so I'm going to push it into the stack. And the next one is operation. The operation is plus operation. So plus operations hamari the first two, this is the top of the stack na, so operations in dono ke beech mein hi lagega, in do operands ke beech mein hi lagega. So what we are going to do is ki first we pop this, then we operate this function plus, and then we pop this one. So 3 plus 3, so we pop these two operands, right? And we operate this function addition, because addition is here. So 3 plus 3 is equal to 6. So 3 is the, you know, 3 is already present in the stack. Now I'm going to push this result into the stack. So 6 is present here now. Okay, now move further. So the when we traverse this whole expression, so the next one is operand. So what I'm going to do is I'm directly push into the stack. Now the next one is this power operation, right? So I'm going to stop here, right? And first task is just pop the element. So I pop it, then I apply this power operation, and then I'm going to pop the second operand. Okay, so this is going to be pop and this is going to be pop. Now the left one is 3 only, so I'm just copying here. Now this is going to be 3 raised to power 6. It is I think this is 729. Okay, 3 into 3 into 3, 6 times. So this is going to be 729. So this is the result. So I'm going to push this result into the stack. Okay, now I'm going to further. So the next operand is 3, so I'm going to push it into the stack. Now the next one is operation, so I'm going to pop the two operands. So first I pop 3, then I apply this operation plus, and the next operand is 729. Okay, and this one is, I'm just copying it here. So 729 plus 3 is equal to 732. So this is the result. So I'm going to push into the stack. Now the next one is, so this is plus is over now. So the next one is 3. Okay, so the next one is 3. So I'm going to push it into the stack. Okay, now 7, next one is plus operation, so just pop 3, then pop 732 plus operation is there, so this is going to be 735. So 3 is, I'm just copying here and I'm just putting this result into the stack. So this is 735. The next one is multiplication, so I'm going to pop these two operation on these two operands and apply this multiplication, and this is 3. So when you multiply 3 into 735, it will come 2205. Okay, so option 3 is the right one. This is the value of the prefix expression. Now question number 26 is, which of the following statement is not true with respect to microwaves? Okay, so let's talk about each statement one by one, and then we'll find out which statement is not true. As you know about the electromagnetic spectrum, right? So you know that we have different type of electromagnetic radiations, like I'm just writing here, electromagnetic radiations. We have different type of electromagnetic radiations, and many types of radiations, you know that it's coming from the, you know, from stars, from suns, like, so we have different types. Different in the first type is like gamma radiations, Then we have X-ray radiations, UV radiations, visible light radiations, and infrared radiations, microwave radiation, and we have radio wave are there. Okay, so these many types of electromagnetic radiations we have, and they are talking about specific microwaves. Okay, so I'm just highlighting this part. Okay, now they are talking about, first statement is talking about the frequencies. So I'm writing here the frequencies of these radiations. Okay, so frequency kya hota hai? Basically frequency hoti hai ki, because ye jo radiations hoti hai, ye waves ki form mein hoti hai, like this. Okay, agar koi se sun se bhi, agar koi star se hamari radiations aaye to waves ki form mein aa rahi hai. To frequency hum kaise calculate karte hain ki the number of waves per second are produced. So this is the frequency of that particular radiation, right? Now if we talk about the specific microwave radiations frequency, then the range of this is from 300 megahertz to 300 gigahertz. So this is, if we talk about the particular frequency of microwave, so this is the range of microwave frequency. Okay, now they are saying that electromagnetic waves with frequencies 300 gigahertz to 400 terahertz. So the range is not correct. The range is 300 megahertz to 300 megahertz to gigahertz. And if we talk about the infrared frequency, the range is around 300 gigahertz to 400 terahertz. So if you go from this side, from radio waves to gamma radiations, the frequency is going to be very, very large. Okay, so radio waves, I'm writing here, so radio waves has the lowest frequency, and when we move from lowest to from bottom to top, when we move from here to here, the frequency is going to be increased. So the gamma radiations, which is present from here, so the gamma radiation has highest frequency. So this is the first, second, third, fourth, fifth, sixth, seventh. Okay, and if we talk about the wavelength area they covered, so area wise if we talk about the radio wave, so the radio waves have the larger wavelengths will cover some kilometers areas, and the gamma radiation is very limited, so the wavelength is very small. So if we talk about the wavelength, so we are going from top to bottom, the wavelength is going to be increased. And if we talk about the frequency, so gamma radiations has a highest frequency and the radio waves has lowest frequency. And just remind these frequency ranges. So if we talk about the visible radiations ranges around 400 so this is 400 terahertz to around 700 terahertz. Okay, and so I'm writing the UV radiations, X-ray and gamma radiations are like they are going to be 700 terahertz to they are around 750 terahertz to gigahertz. Okay, and this is going to be 30 gigahertz to 300 hertz, and this is going to be more than, you can say the 15 e hertz. Okay, so this is the frequency range of these, you know, particular radiations. Now you can see that yes, the microwave radiations are not coming under this range, so this statement number one is wrong. Now the next statement is propagation is line of sight, means microwaves ka jo propagation rehta hai wo line of sight hai. Okay, so we have different propagation methods. One thing I want to tell you that this specific topic जो ये electromagnetic radiations की types हैं, frequency है and propagation methods, इन पे already questions, you know, this is previous year paper 2016, 2014 में भी question आया हुआ, 2013 में भी question आया, so just make note of this whatever I'm writing here, because it will be useful for you to solve, you know, further questions related to this specific topic. Okay, so propagation methods, we have different propagation methods. Jaise ki first one is ground propagation, second one is if we talk about sky propagation, and the third one is line of sight propagation. So I'm just writing the short form line of sight, okay, or I'm writing here line of sight. So ground propagation mein kya hota hai? So this is our earth, okay, so in ground propagation some antennas are here and some towers are here, and the frequency are going to be from here to here. Okay, and in the ground propagation, so the frequency jo range rehti hai ground propagation ke andar is around, the range is around 300 to 300 kilohertz, right? It's very small. इसका मतलब जो आपकी रेडियो वेव्स है, रेडियो वेव्स की जो रेंज रहती है वो अराउंड रहती है 3 किलो हर्ट्स टू 300 गीगा हर्ट्स. इट मींस जो ग्राउंड प्रोपिगेशन मेथड पे दिस, यू नो, रेडियो वेव आपकी प्रोपिगेट करती है, तो रेडियो वेव्स के लिए यू हैव ग्राउंड प्रोपिगेशन मेथड एंड दे आर यूजिंग वेरी low frequency, because it is very low frequency, so it's very useful for the radio waves. So you can say that in ground propagation mein radio waves travel through the lowest portion of the atmosphere, travels to the lowest level of the atmosphere. So these low frequency signals travel in all the directions from the transmitting, so these are the transmitting antennas. So you can write it here, radio waves. So lowest level pe jo atmosphere pe jo travel karti hai waves, wo hamari radio waves. And you know that radio waves ki jo application hai wo hamari radio communication ke andar hai, TV ke andar hai, mobile phones ke andar hai, right? And the second one is sky propagation. Sky propagation mein kya hota hai ki if this is our earth and these are some transmitting or receiving antennas, and you know हमारी एक और atmosphere की layer होती है, उसका नाम होता है ionosphere. Okay, ionosphere. So यहाँ से क्या होता है कि अगर आप कोई waves को transmit कर रहे हो तो वो यहाँ से यहाँ bend होकर finally receive to this antennas. So फर्स्ट थिंग इज कि इसकी जो रेंज रहती है, द रेंज ऑफ द स्काई प्रोपिगेशन मेथड इज 300 to 300 मेगा हर्ट्स, मतलब स्लाइटली हायर देन द ग्राउंड लेवल फ्रिक्वेंसी. तो इसकी रेंज थोड़ी सी अप हो जाती है, 300 to 300 मेगा हर्ट्स. दिस अ मीडियम लेवल, यू कैन से दैट दिस इज अ मीडियम लेवल फ्रिक्वेंसी प्रोपिगेट इन दिस प्रोपिगेशन मेथड, मीडियम लेवल फ्रिक्वेंसी, यू कैन राइट इट हियर. So in this case, so this is antenna, so the antenna signal is reflected, you know, the antenna signals are reflected from this ionized layer of atmosphere back or down to the earth like this. So it propagates like this. So it will strike first to the ionosphere, then it will come down, then it go back and here, and then finally received by this antenna. Okay. Now the next one is line of sight. So first thing I want to tell you that the frequency range is, now you can see that 3 to 3 megahertz ki range mein hamare yahan. So kaun si category iske andar aati hai? So around इसमें भी ये radio waves ही काम करेगी, sky में भी radio waves ही काम करेगी, because 3 megahertz to 300 gigahertz microwaves के, so they are not coming under in this sky propagation method. So line of sight की जो frequency range है वो है 3 to 300 gigahertz, and if this is our earth and this is the transmitting antenna and this is the receiving antenna, and they should be placed at the line of sight. What does it mean? It means that transmitting and the receiving antenna must be in line of sight. Inka jo distance hai ye ek dusre ki lines mein should be placed. Okay, so hamari jo rate jo waves hai wo should be traverse like this, not like like this, or not like back and forth. It should be go like this. Okay, and 3 to 300 gigahertz, if this the range of the line of sight, so microwaves will come under this category of this propagation method. So the propagation method for microwaves are line of sight. Okay, so the microwaves are propagate like this. Okay, now so they are saying that in the statement number 2, propagation is line of sight for microwaves. Yes, this statement is true. Now in the statement number 3, very high frequency waves cannot penetrate walls. Yes, this is true, because this characteristics you can say this characteristics can be a disadvantage, because if receivers are are sitting inside the building, then it is not able to receive this kind of waves. So this is true. And the next one is, use of certain portion of band requires permission from authorities. Yes, this is also true. Agar aap koi particular band ko agar aap portion ko use karna chahte hain, to you need permission from the authorities. So option 4 is also true. So option 1 is the one which is false for the microwaves. Now question number 27, in a fast ethernet cabling, 100 base TX uses which cable, and maximum segment size is what? So I'm just telling you the brief knowledge about the ethernet, uske different types and kaun se wo pairs use karte hain, and un pairs un cables ka kya kya length rehti hai, because I have already seen in some previous year papers that about this ethernet cabling, this question is repeated 2 or 3 times. So that's why I'm going to give you some brief knowledge, and then I'll come back to this question. Okay, so you know about LAN, because LAN is a LAN is a computer network that is designed for some limited geographical area. Okay, and if you talk about the LAN market, so LAN market has seen several technologies. The LANs are like Ethernet or like token ring, token bus, and so on. Okay, but we are specifically talk about the Ethernet only, because the Ethernet is very it's very dominant technology, and it is cheaper than token ring and token bus. That's why it's more famous than token ring and token bus. Okay, also we have some some speed variation in the Ethernet, like we have 10 Mbps speed is there in Ethernet, 100 Mbps is there, 1000 Mbps is also there in Ethernet. Okay, and let's talk about the generation of the Ethernet. We have 4 generations. Ethernet has 4 generation Ethernet. The first one is standard Ethernet. Next one is fast Ethernet. Next is gigabit ethernet, and the last one is 10 gigabit ethernet. Okay, so I'm telling you now, there's a speed variations, there is a speed variation is possible in the ethernet because of the different generations. So the first one is standard ethernet. The speed of the standard ethernet is, so I'm just changing the color. So the speed of the standard ethernet is 10 Mbps. If we are using the fast ethernet, the speed is around 100 Mbps. If we talk about the gigabit ethernet, the speed is around can say not 1000 Mbps, so write it 1 gigabit Mbps, gigabit per second. And the next one is 10 gigabit ethernet, so that this is 10 gigabit per second, as the name suggests. Okay, so these are the speed. So ethernet provides a different variation of speed because they are using different generations. So standard ethernet is 10 Mbps, fast ethernet is 100 Mbps, gigabit ki 1 gigabit per second, and this one is 10 gigabit per second. So in question we are talking about the fast ethernet. So the fast ethernet speed is 100 Mbps. Okay, now let's talk about the fast ethernet only. Okay, so for fast ethernet, if we talk about the specific fast ethernet, so the fast ethernet implementation is with the help of three kinds. So the first one is 100 base TX, next one is 100 base FX, and the last one is 100 base T4. So the 100 base TX ka matlab kya hai ki 100 base TX ka matlab hai ki we are using 100 meter length of the cable. Okay, so we are using the 100 length, maximum length of the cable is 100 meter, and base TX ka matlab kya hai ki we are using two pair of twisted cable. We are using the two pair of twisted cable, and the maximum length of the cable is, and the maximum length of cable is 100 meter. In the 100 base FX means we are using the two pair of fiber optic cable, and length is also same, maximum length is also 100 meter. Okay, and the next one is 100 base T4 means we are using the maximum length is 100, and we are using here 4 category 3 UTP used twisted cable. Okay, now so let's come back to our question. In a fast ethernet cabling, 100 base TX, now you know that this represent the length of the cable. So the length of the cable is 100 base TX, it means we are using two pair of twisted cable. So the correct answer is A. So this is twisted pair cable, and the maximum segment size is 100 meter. So this question number 28 is, a network with bandwidth of 10 Mbps can pass only an average 12,000 frames per second per minute, with each frame carrying an average of 10,000 bits. What is the throughput of this network? Now, so this is the network capacity. So this is the bandwidth of network is equal to 10 Mbps. Okay, so this is the 10 Mbps is the network capacity. Okay, first thing. Now, second thing is, it can pass if there is one network, and this is the bandwidth is already given 10 Mbps, can pass only an average of 12,000 frames. How many number of frames are there? 12,000 frames per minute. Okay, so in network they pass 12,000 frames per minute. And in the next line, they said that each frame, matlab, you have 12,000 number of frames. 1, 2, up to 12,000 frames. Okay? In the network. And each frame means if we are talking about this particular frame, each frame carrying an average of 10,000 bits. 10,000 bits. 10,000 bits is all present in this frame. 10,000 frame bits present in this frame and so on. Okay, so each frame contains 10,000 bits. And how many number of frames are there? 12,000. So if 12,000 frames are there and each contain 10,000 bits, that's why we are multiplying with 10,000 bits. Now 12,000 frames into 10,000 bits per minute. Now you can see that the bandwidth is in seconds, not in a minute. So that's why we are converting this minute into seconds. And when we convert minute into, you know, second, we divide by 60. So this is 12,000 into 10,000 divide by, this is minute, so we are converted into the seconds. So this is, so 6 to the 12. Now this is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So 6, it means 2 into 10 raised to power 6. And you know that 10 raised to power 6 is megabits per second. So this is 2 megabits per second. Although the network capacity is 10 Mbps, but we are, you know, we are giving the frame is, the capacity is 2 Mbps, okay. So option 2 is the, now let's come to question number 29. This is a match the following, and this is a OSI layers, session layer, application layer, presentation layer, and transport layer, and match with their functionality. Okay, so this is it. So let's talk about each layer one by one, and then functionality, and then we will match with their corresponding functionality. Okay, first I draw the OSI model. Okay, so OSI model, you know that in the OSI model, the lowest layer is physical layer, the next layer is data link layer, after that which layer? Network layer, then transport layer, then session layer. How many layers total? 7. And after session layer, next layer is presentation layer, and the topmost layer is application layer. So in the question, they are asking about application, presentation, session, and transport layer. Okay, first four layers: application, presentation, session, and transport. Now let's talk about first application layer, the functionality of the application layer. So in application layer, there is a interface between the user and software. So there is one software is virtual terminal software. So virtual terminal software, basically it's an application service where users allow to enter the information of credit card into the, you can say, into a virtual terminal, so that the informations like username or passwords. So all kinds of applications are come under the application layer. So the correct matching of the application layer is virtual terminal software, right? Now the next layer is presentation layer. So what is the functionality of the presentation layer is all kinds of syntax, semantics, encryption, decryption is happen at this layer. Okay, so semantics or the information transmitted at that presentation layer, all kinds of encryption, you can say all kinds of encryption, all kind of decryption of message happen at this layer. Okay, now the next one is, next layer is session layer. Session layer functionality is what? So session layer, basically the major two, you can say major two application is for application functionality. This session layer functionality is, two main functionality of the session layer is, first one is dialogue control. Dialogue control. And the second one is synchronization. Synchronization. So in the dialogue control, in which it tells that in which mode two system are connected. Okay, if two system are there, this is system A and this is system B. So they are saying that in the dialogue control states that in which mode these two systems are connected, whether it's a half duplex, whether it's a half duplex, or whether it's a full duplex. Okay, so dialogue control talks about this, in which mode the two systems are connected. And what about synchronization? So synchronization is kya hoti hai ki it allows a process to add checkpoints which are considered as a, you can say, synchronization points into stream of data. Okay, if there is example, if a system sending a file, if this is a system and this system sending a file to another system, right? So if a system sending a file of, let's suppose in this file 800 pages are there. So if in this file 800 pages are there, in this we are going to add checkpoints. Checkpoints. Okay. Let's suppose humne checkpoints ko dala after each 50 pages. 50 pages complete hue, then we add one checkpoint. Okay. So isse hamara kya fayda hoga ki agar humne checkpoints yahan dala. So uska fayda kya hoga ki this will ensure that 50 pages unit is successfully received and acknowledged. Agar yahan kahin hamara ये फाइल करप्ट होती है तो हमें ये पता लग जाएगा कि ओके टिल देन 50 और 50 इट मींस टोटल 100 पेजेस आर इंश्योर्ड सक्सेसफुली रिसीव्ड भी हुए और उनको हमें एक्नॉलेजमेंट भी मिल गई. सो दिस इज द फंक्शनैलिटी ऑफ सिंक्रोनाइजेशन कि अगर कोई आप कोई पेजेस या कोई फ्रेम आप डाल रहे हो तो उसमें अंदर वो क्या करते हैं कि पेजेस के अंदर दे आर एडिंग चेक पॉइंट्स. इन सिंक्रोनाइजेशन they are adding checkpoints so that we get to know that how many number of bits are successfully received and acknowledged and how many, you know, how many number of bits are left which are not acknowledged or collapsed ho gaye ya fir corrupt ho gaye, right? So this is the functionality of synchronization. Or dialogue control ki kya hai ki this will tell us the mode in which mode the two systems are connected, whether it's a half duplex or whether it's a full duplex mode. Now session layer manage dialogue control. Okay, dialogue control ko manage karegi then so that we are able to know ki jin do system, do host ke beech mein hum information ka transaction kar rahe hain to wo kis mode mein connected hai, right? So this is the functionality of session layer. Now the last one is transport layer. Transport layer functionality is flow control. See, flow control is a functionality of transport layer also, is a functionality of transport layer and data link also. Flow control. But there is a slight difference in the data link layer. It you can say it control local flow control and there is global flow control. So flow control hota kya hai? Let's suppose these two systems are there, host A and host B, and host A उसे फ्रेम्स सेंड कर रहा है, ठीक है. एंड फ्रेम बी के पास एक बफर है जहाँ पर जब वो सेंड कर रहा है तो फर्स्ट दे आर यू नो दे आर स्टोर्ड इन दिस बफर व्हेन दिस, और फिर उसके बाद बिट्स यहाँ से होके फिजिकल लेयर देन डेटा लिंक लेयर देन ट्रांसपोर्ट लेयर, तो इस तरह से यहाँ तक जाएगी. ओके, सो व्हेन दिस बफर, जब ये बफर फुल हो जाएगा, इन दैट केस यहाँ से एक इंफॉर्मेशन जाएगी कि प्लीज़ आप अपनी स्पीड को जो आप ट्रांजेक्ट कर रहे हो, आप अपने मैसेजेस को आप भेज रहे हो, प्लीज़ स्लो डाउन योर स्पीड सो दैट मैं इन जो अवेलेबल हमारे पास जो फ्रेम्स अभी हमारे बफर्स के अंदर है कि वो प्रोसेस हो जाए एंड यहाँ पर स्पेस बने और फिर हम जो नए हमारे फ्रेम्स आ रहे हैं वो मैं स्टोर कर सकूँ. तो इस तरह की जो इन्फॉर्मेशन, इस तरह की जो फंक्शनैलिटी जो हमें प्रोवाइड करता है वो होता है फ्लो कंट्रोल, फ्लो को कंट्रोल करना. सो ये हमें डेटा लिंक लेयर पे भी प्रोवाइड करवाते हैं और ये हमें ट्रांसपोर्ट लेयर भी प्रोवाइड करवाते हैं. बट देयर इज अ स्लाइट डिफरेंस, यहाँ पर ग्लोबल फ्लो कंट्रोल और यहाँ पर क्या है लोकल फ्लो कंट्रोल. ओके, सो करेक्ट मैचिंग इज सेशन लेयर इज फोर्थ एंड एप्लीकेशन लेयर इज फर्स्ट, प्रेजेंटेशन लेयर इज सेकेंड. एंड क्वेश्चन नंबर 30 इज विच ऑफ द फॉलोइंग प्रोटोकॉल्स इज यूज्ड बाय ईमेल सर्वर टू मेंटेन अ सेंट्रल रिपोजिटरी दैट कैन बी एक्सेस्ड फ्रॉम एनी मशीन. ओके, सो लेट्स सपोज दिस इज अ सेंडर एंड दिस इज रिसीवर टू हुम यू आर सेंडिंग द मेल. So this person is receiver. Two person I have now. So to send the mail, so this is the, you know, this is the server of sender. This is the server of sender. So this is a Gmail server, right? Now this ID of this, you can say, the ID of this is abc@gmail.com. So this is the Gmail server, or you can say that this is a sender server, right? Now with the help of to send the mail to the server we need one protocol. The protocol is SMTP. So I am writing here the functionality of the SMTP. So the first thing is about SMTP is the full form of the SMTP is Simple Mail Transfer Protocol. So as the name suggests, a simple mail transfer protocol. So इसकी functionality सिर्फ इतना ही है कि अगर आपके पास कोई mail है, let's suppose this is the mail. So functionality of SMTP protocol की यही है कि वो transfer करता है sender के system से server के server तक. ओके, सेंडर के सिस्टम से होस्ट टू द होस्ट सर्वर. ओके, सो दिस इज अ फंक्शनैलिटी एंड यू कैन से दैट इट सिंपली पुश द मेल, फ्रॉम क्लाइंट टू क्लाइंट सर्वर. ओके, नाउ हमारा मेल प्लेस्ड एट द क्लाइंट सर्वर, राइट. नाउ हमें क्या कहाँ भेजना है, रिसीवर को. अब क्या होगा कि इन बिटवीन देयर इज अ नेटवर्क. ओके, दिस इज द इंटरनेट, सो इट पासिस फ्रॉम हियर. ओके, एंड नाउ दिस मेल reaches at receiver, not receiver, let's suppose the ID of this person is xyz@yahoo.com. So this is a Yahoo server, or you can say the recipient server. So now our mail reaches at receiver server. Okay. So server से Yahoo के server पर पहुंचने के लिए Gmail server to Yahoo server तक transfer करने के लिए और you can say the push करने के लिए mail को भी SMTP की ही help हम लेते हैं. SMTP protocol is used to push the mail from client server to receiver server. So we push the mail, SMTP push the mail from client server, or you can say also push the mail from client server to receiver server. Okay, now the job of this SMTP is finished here. At this point is finished. Okay, so all push jo work of push is complete now. Now the receiver is going to be pull the mail from the Yahoo server. Yahoo server means receiver ka jo server hai. यहाँ पर हम क्या करेंगे कि pop operation को हम apply करेंगे and pop operation को apply करने के लिए we have two protocols. First protocol name is POP3 and the second protocol name is IMAP. So I'm writing here SMTP is used for push operation. Push. We are pushing the mail. First we are push the mail from sender to sender server. Then we push the mail from sender server to receiver server. And then receiver pop the mail from receiver server. So they are used for the pop operation. Okay. Now, for pop operation we are using two protocols. POP3 and IMAP. Okay, the functionality of both the protocols are same, but there is a slight difference. This is the IMAP. Basically, this is the this is the extension of POP3. मतलब POP3 की जो functionality है वो IMAP की functionality, but कुछ extra features हैं जो IMAP हमें provide करता है जो POP3 provide नहीं करता. तो first thing is, what is the full form of the POP is Post Office Protocol and 3 is version 3. Okay, so basically you can write is this POP3 protocol is a message access agent. Okay, or you can write it down like it POP3 protocol pull, not pop. You can write pull, this is the best word. Okay, so it pull the mail from the server. Okay, and this POP3 basically is very simple, and POP3 protocol has a limited functionality, right? So isme kya hota hai ki whenever the receiver pull the mail from the server, so mail is basically deleted from the mailbox after receiver received it. Okay, so delete mode is going to be open. There is some drawbacks of POP3, like we are not able to the receiver is not able to organize the mails which is present at this server. So receiver are not able to manage their mails which is present in the server. So this functionality is not present in the POP3. Or some other functionality like no separate folders on servers. Sare ke sare jo hamari mails hai wo एक साथ ही रखी है. ऐसा नहीं है कि कुछ पर्टिकुलर पर्सन ने अगर भेजी है तो वो एक फोल्डर में हो, कुछ और किसी और कोई जो ऑफिस रिलेटेड कोई इम्पोर्टेंट emails hai wo kisi aur folder mein, so this kind of functionality is not present in the POP3 protocol. That's why humne ek naya protocol leke aaya jo jiska naam hai IMAP. The full form of IMAP is Internet Mail Access Protocol. Mail Access Protocol. As I already told you that functionality IMAP ki bhi same rahegi jo POP3 ki thi. It's also a message access agent. It's also the, you know, pull the mail from the server, but there is some extra features is also there. Like with the help of IMAP, now the receiver is able to manage the mails which is present in the mail. Right, user can also check mails with the help with the header, okay, without going through the entire mail. They are able to see the header, like subject or kisne use bheja hai, like, and all this kind of informations. And user can search the content of mail also. So this kind, all this, all the functionality, there's some extra features which is you know, we are seeing is present in the ICMP. Extra features. Okay, we can also partially download our mails with the help of IMAP, or user can create, you can say delete or you know, rename the mailbox which is present on the server. So all the extra features are present in IMAP. So now come back to our question. Which of the following of protocols is used for mail server, email server to maintain a central repository that can be accessed from any machine? Means it's unlike the POP3. Means in POP3 we are using their user personal computer only. We are able to access from the user personal computer only. But in IMAP, IMAP ek, basically this is a protocol where we are using the Gmail server to maintain the central repository that can be accessed from any machine. From any machine we are able to access it, not only the user's personal computer. Okay, so this functionality basically provided by IMAP, or you can say that POP3, IMAP and SMTP are these three protocols which we are using in the email, the whole email transactions. But DMCP is not a protocol of for emails. So these three are the protocols, but this one particular functionality is provided by IMAP, which is Internet Mail Access Protocol. Okay. Now question number 31. The number of strings of length 4 that are generated by the regular expression. So this is the expression, and where this is an alteration character. Alteration character means either we are using this, either we are using this, or we are able to use both of them. And plus and this this star are the quantification characters, right? Now हमें क्या करना है कि हमें 4 लेंथ की स्ट्रिंग को जनरेट करना है विद द हेल्प ऑफ दिस, राइट? नाउ सो दिस इज प्लस साइन मींस यू आर नॉट एबल टू यूज एप्सिलॉन, ओके, बट द होल स्टार मींस यू आर एबल टू यूज एप्सिलॉन, ओके. नाउ सो देयर आर सम कॉम्बिनेशन ऑफ द नंबर ऑफ आई एम राइटिंग हियर. The number of strings, number of strings of length 4. Now the first is, now you can see that this is the alteration character means either you can use this, either you can use this, or you can use both. Okay, initially I'm using this one. This let's suppose this is x, this is y. I'm just erasing it. Okay, so let's suppose this is x, this is y, right? So they are saying that it's like this, x/y means either you can use x or you can use y or you can use both of them, right? So initially hame kya karna hai ki different combinations se hame different strings banani hai, right? So first is 0 1 ke upar plus sign hai, it means hame in dono ko include karna hi karna, but there is a possibility ki hum ise hame Why ko include na kare? Because star is there, right? So first string which is possible is 0 1. अब हमें four क्या करना है कि four length four ही रखनी है, तो that's why I'm going to repeat this 0 1. और इसे मैं क्या लगा रही हूँ यहाँ पर स्टार पे जीरो, सो आई एम नॉट इंक्लूडिंग दिस y. ओके, सो दिस इज द फर्स्ट थिंग विच इज पॉसिबल, द लेंथ इज फोर. नाउ द नेक्स्ट वन इज आई एम गोइंग टू रिपीट 0 0, सो द फोर्थ लेंथ स्ट्रिंग इज आई एम गोइंग टू रिपीट 0 0 एंड आई एम कीपिंग इट वन ऑल्सो 1 1. ओके, नाउ थर्ड वन इज लाइक आई एम गोइंग टू इंक्लूड ऑल ऑफ द नंबर्स, लाइक आई एम गोइंग टू इंक्लूड x एंड y ऑल्सो. So this is 0 1, x is 0 1 and the y is 2 3. Now I'm just changing the color. Okay, now the next one is, now in the next case I'm going to, first I'm using y, I can alter it, right? First I'm using y and then I'm using x. So the y is 2 3 and x is 0 1. There is also one, this is a one possible case is there. Now in the next one, I'm not using this x. Before I not using y and I'm not using x. So I'm repeating 2, 3 and 2, 3. Okay. There's a case when I'm repeating 2, 2 and then 3, 3. So six possibilities are there. Now the left one is like I'm writing 0 and 3 times 1. Or there is a possibility that 3 times 0 and 1 times 1. Okay. Now, same in the case of y. 1 times 2, 3 times 3. And 3 times 2 and 1 times 3. So, these are the number of combinations which is possible with the help of this 0, 1 and 2, 3. And the length of the string is 4. So, now count, this is a 10 number of strings are there of length 4. So, option 3rd is the right one. Now, question number 32 is, the content of the accumulator after the execution of the following 8085 assembly language program is. So, number of instructions are there. So, first thing is, I am going to number it. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and 6. Okay, and now we are going step by step. So first instruction says that move immediately A, so this accumulator 35H, so this hexadecimal value, this hexadecimal value we are going to put it into the accumulator. So let's suppose this is accumulator A and we are going to store 35H in the hexadecimal value in the accumulator. Okay, now the next instruction is move BA. So when this is a move instruction is there, it doesn't mean that let's suppose this is a B register, general purpose register, and we are moving 35H. So it doesn't mean that there is nothing is present here now because it moves here. Basically, move operation copy the content which is present in one register to another register. That's it. Okay, so just remind this. Now the next instruction is, so this is set carry flag. So the full form of this instruction is set carry flag. Okay, now there is one carry flag. So the carry flag को हमें क्या करना है, initially वो 0 था तो हमने 0 से उसको क्या कर दिया 1, right? Now next instruction is carry flag complement. So CMC is carry flag को हमें क्या करना है, complement करना है, मतलब पहले वो 0 था फिर हमने उसे सेट किया तो 1 हो गया, अब हमें फाइनली इसको कॉम्प्लीमेंट करके 0 कर देना है. ओके, सो फाइनली हमारा क्या हुआ कि कैरी फ्लैग की वैल्यू क्या हुई, 0 फाइनली. नाउ द फिफ्थ इंस्ट्रक्शंस से दैट दिस इज RAR, द फुल फॉर्म इज रोटेट एक्यूमुलेटर, मतलब एक्यूमुलेटर का जो कंटेंट है, राइट राइट साइड थ्रू कैरी, थ्रू कैरी. नाउ व्हाट डज इट मीन? नाउ दिस इज द कैरी फ्लैग, इज वैल्यू इज जीरो. नाउ द वैल्यू विच इज प्रेजेंट इन एक्यूमुलेटर, so this is 3. You know that in the hexadecimal each digit is represented by 4 bits, so this is 0 0 1 and 1, right? And this is 5, so this is 0 1 0 1. Okay, now they said that rotate accumulator right through carry. It means that you have to rotate each bit right shift, and the value which is present in carry is going to be append at the end. Okay, so this is it. Now the finally we got, so 8 places are here, 1 2 3 4 5 6 7 and 8, 1 2 3 4 5 6 7 and 8, and this is the carry. Now each bit is shifted at right hand side, so this one is going to be present here, because right shift na, so one is present here. Aur jo ye zero hai, ye rotate hoke going to be append here. So this going to be append here, and each bit is going to be shifted. So this zero is shifted here, this zero is shifted here, this one is going to be shifted here, this one is shifted here, this zero is shifted here, this one is shifted here, and this zero is shifted here. Aur jo ye one tha, ye shifted here. Okay, now so finally we got this after applying this instruction, and the last instruction is XOR A XOR B. The content which is present in A and B, we have to XOR it. Now accumulator contain this, and B mein hamara kya tha, 35H. Okay, so accumulator well content is 000 11 010, got it, 4 and 48. Yes, and what is the content which is present in B is 35H, right? So 35 is 0011 and 5 is 0101, and we have to apply the XOR operation. And you know that in the XOR operation, when two values are different, we got 1, and when two values are same, we got 0 when we apply the XOR operation. So 0 and 1 is 1, 1 0 is 1, 0 1 is 1, 1 0 is 1, this is 0, this is 1, this is 0, and this is 0. So finally we got, this is 2 and this is 15, means F, and this is a hexadecimal value. So finally the answer we got is 2FH. So fourth one is the right one. Question number 33 is, in compiler optimization, operator strength reduction use mathematical identities to replace slow math operations with faster operations. Which of the following code replacements is an illustration of operator strength reduction? It means that in the operator strength reduction, we use in the compiler operator strength reduction. Isme hum kya karte hain ki we are going to replace expensive operations by inexpensive operations, or expensive operations like multiplication. So we replace by addition, right? How? So when we this is 2 plus 2 plus 2 is 6, right? And 3 into 2 is also 6. So this is, multiplication is always an expensive operation, but the addition is the inexpensive operation. So we are replacing this by this. Okay. So this is operator strength reduction. Okay. Although we know that, yes, This multiplication is the faster operations than the addition, but this is a costly. So here we are talking about the costlier operations, not talking about the fast or slow operations. Now, the first one is replace p plus p by 2 multiply p, or replace 3 plus 4 by 7. Now you know that this is multiplication is an expensive operation and this one is costly. So plus ko agar hum multiply se replace karein, so this is not a good option, so this is not correct. Now we replace p multiply 32 by left shift 5. Now so you have to just remember these two things. Left shift, what is the functionality of the left shift, and what is the functionality of the right shift. So जैसे इसमें हमने किया है कि 5 left shift, so जब भी हम left shift करते हैं, so it means that we are multiplying it, and whenever we are doing some right operations, so it means we are dividing it by 2^5. Okay, so in this we are using the left shift at the place of multiplication. Multiplication क्या है कि हमारा expensive operation है, but left shift is less expensive operation, so we are able to do this. Now replace p into 0 by 0, it makes no sense. Now replace p, this is left shift, and by multiplication, left shift एक less expensive operation को हम expensive operation के साथ replace करेंगे, so this is not a good option. So all these are incorrect, only option number 2 is the right one. Question number 34 is, which of the following are the principal tasks of the linker? So you have to tell the principal task of the linker. Okay, now let's talk about some basic basic thing about the program, and then we will I will tell you that how linker work in the program. Okay, now you know that there is a source code you are writing in any language. So if this is a source code, now so this source code first go to the preprocessor. So what is the functionality of the preprocessor is going to be, you can say it going to be replace all the, you can say it's going to be replace all the hash directives from your source code. So it will remove all hash directives and all, and then the whole program it's going to be compiled. So you know that in the compilation different layers are there, like lexical analyzer, syntax analyzer, semantic, intermediate code optimization. So all the things is going to be done in the compilation, and after compilation finally the product is assembly. We got assembly language program. So this assembly language program is converted by assembler. This assembler is going to be convert this assembly language program into machine code, or you can say object code. Right? Now linker comes into the picture, and now I'm telling you what is the functionality of linker. Okay, as you know that we have some different library functions, we are using some different library functions in our programs. Library functions like printf, scanf, these are library functions. Okay, now what is the functionality of linker? Humne kya kiya ki these are the external references, these are the library functions printf, scanf. So we have to link these library functions with our object code. So this is the task of the linker. Now, the functionality of the linker is, linker links the external libraries with our main program, or you can say with main program, so that it will convert into the executable file. I'm writing here the definition of linker is, so linker is, or you can say the working or task of the linker is, so basically, so these are the library function Now linker is, linker going to be links the external libraries, and link with the object code, or you can say machine code, so that it will convert into executable file. Okay, so this is the functionality of linker. So all kinds of linking, whether it's code linking or whether it's a data linking, it's done by the linker. So this is the functionality. Now come back to our question. So the first point is resolve external references among separately compiled program units. Yes. So this is the functionality of linker. So I'm writing here, this is done by linker. Now the second one is translate assembly language to machine code. I've already told you that this is a functionality of assembler. Jo assembly language program ko, or you can say assembly language ko machine code ke andar convert karta hai. So this is a functionality of assembler, not linker. Okay. Now relocate code and data relative to the beginning of the program. Yes, all kind of linking, whether it's for code linking or whether it's a data linking, is done by the linker. So this is a task of the linker. And the next one is enforce access control restrictions on system libraries, which basically this is not a task of linker, this is a task of operating system. So this is not true. So option number second is the right. Now question number 35, which one of the following is false? Now the question number 36 is, consider a system with 7 processes A through G and 6 resources R through W. Okay, so we have processes like processes from A to Z, and we are represent process with the circle and the resources with the rectangular. Okay, so let's suppose A is the process, B is the process, C is the process, D is the process, E is the process, and E, F, and then G. So 7 processes are there, and the resources are from R to W. So R resources I'm going to represent by squares, then this is R, S, this is T, this is U, this is V, and this is W. So 6 resources and the 7 processes. Okay, now read all the instructions one by one. So this is, first is process A holds R and wants T. It means process A ke paas resource R hai, but process A needs T resource. Okay, so isne is resource ko hold kiya hua, that's why arrow will come from this side, and wants T, use want T resource, so A wants T. Okay, so this is over. Now process B holds nothing, it's hold nothing but wants T, usse bhi kya chahiye, T chahiye, right? So this is over. Now the next one is process C holds nothing but wants S. Process C holds nothing but wants S. Okay, so this is over. Now the next one is process D holds U, holds U like this, and wants S and T, and wants S and T. Okay, so this is over. Now process E holds T and wants V. Process E holds T, holds T like this. Okay, and wants V, and wants V. So this is over. Now the next one is process F holds W. Process F holds W and wants S. Wait a second. So this is process F wants S. Now process G holds V. Process G hold V and wants U. And wants U. Okay. Now this is also over. So we have to identify whether the system is in deadlock or not. And if the process is in deadlock, then you have to tell that which processes are in deadlock. Okay. So when the system is in deadlocked, when this situation is summarized, like let's suppose we have two processes in our question. Seven processes are there. Let's suppose two processes are here, and the number of resources also two, like this. So in this case, this resource is allocated to this process, and this process wants this process, so it requests R2, and R2 is basically allocated to process P2, but P2 requests R1, which is already allocated to P1. So in this type of situation, the deadlock will come, because there is a cycle, because P2 wants R1, which is already allocated by P1, and P1 wants R2, which is already allocated by P2. Okay, so in this case, in this situation, deadlock will come. When this type of cycle will come, so you can say that there is a deadlock in the system. Okay, so our task is to find the cycle, in the system. Okay. Now check the dependencies of the processes, like dependencies like A request resource T, but T is already allocated to E. Now we can say that you can write it down like A request T, which is resource, and T is already allocated to process E. Therefore, we can say that A process is dependent on process E. Okay, like this we are going to find the number of processes which is dependent on other processes, like, okay. So now there is a process B. Here I'm in this, in this graph, I'm just drawing the process only, not resources. Okay, so this is A, B, C, and this is D, and here I'm writing E, and this is F, and this is G. Okay, now A is dependent on E. Now see, now check for B. B wants T, and T is allocated by E. Okay, so B is also dependent on E. Okay, now what about C? So C holds nothing, but C want S, and you can see that S is allocated by no one. Yes, S is allocated by no one. Yes, so there is no dependency. Now what about D? You can see that D wants S and T, right? S is not held by anyone, and what about T? T is held by E. So T is held by T, so it means D is dependent on E. Okay, now what about E? So E wants V, and V is held by G, so it means E is dependent on G. Now F, so F is here, F wants S, F wants S and S is not held by anything, so there is no dependencies. And what about G? G holds, G wants U and U is held by D, you can see that. So like this. Now you can see that there is a cycle. There is no cycle here. There is no cycle here, but there is a cycle in the system, right? So we can say that this is a deadlock. And you can easily tell the number of processes which is, which take part in the deadlock is process T, process E, and process G. So option third is the right one. System is in deadlock. Yes, system is in deadlocked. And the process D, E and G are processes which are in deadlocked. Okay. Now question number 27. Suppose that virtual address space has 8 pages and physical memory with 4 page frames. If least recently used LRU page replacement algorithm we used, number of page faults occur with the reference string. Okay. So we have 4 page frames. Okay. So four page frames and we are using the least recently page replacement algorithm. Okay. So first one is 0. So nothing is present. So there is one. So we are putting this 0 is here and there is a fault. So I'm representing fault with this star. Okay. Or you can say miss. Now next one is 2. So 2 is not there, so that's why I'm just putting it and there is a fault, so that's why 1 star. Now 1, so I'm putting 0, 2 and 1 and 1 more star because 1 fault, because 1 is not there. Now 3, size of the frame is 4 only, okay. So this is 0 and 2 and 1 and 3 and star because 3 is also not present. Now these 3 are 4 are over. Now 5. So the size of the frames are 4 only. So I'm going to replace anyone. So this is least recently used. The full form of this algorithm is least recently used. Now tell me which number is least recently used among them. 3 is recently used, then 1, then 2 and then 0. 0 is the one which is least recently used, so I'm going to replace 0 with 5 and all the numbers are remain same, positions are also. So there is a fault, right, because 5 is not present. Now again 4 come and 5 is recently come and 2 is the least, you can say least recently used number, so that's why 4 replace 2 and other numbers remain same and there is a fault because 4 is not present, so that's why I'm putting 1 star. Now the next number is 6. 6 is also not present and 1 is the number which is least recently used, so that's why I'm replacing 1 with the 6 and this is 3 and this is 4 and this is 5 and 6 is also not present, so that's why I'm putting star. And what about 3? So 3 is already there. Yes, there is a hit, so all the number remains same and there is a hit. Okay. Now next one is 7. So 7 is not there. So 3 is recently used, 6 is also recently used, 4 is also recently used and the 5 one is 5th number is the least recently used. So that's why I'm replacing 5 with 7 and all the numbers remain same. And there is a miss because 7 is not there. Now 4. So 4 is there, so there is a hit. Okay, now next one is 7. So 7 is also there, so there is a hit. Now 3. So 3 is also there, so there is a hit. Then again 3, hit. Right, so hit. Now 5. So 5 is not there, so which number is going to be replaced? 3 is recently used, then 7 is also recently used, and 4 is also recently used. So 6 is the least recently used number. Then I'm going to replace 6 with the number 5. So 3, 5, 4 and 7, and there is a miss because 5 is not there. Now again 5 come, so there is a hit because 5 is already there now. 5, 4, 7 and there is a hit. Now next number is 3. So 3 is there, so there is a hit. Now next number is 1. So 3 is recently used, 5 is recently used, and 4 is also recently used, not 7 is recently used before 7, and the 4 is least recently used, so that's why I'm replacing 4 with 1. So this is 3, 5, 1 and 7, and there is a miss because 1 is not there. Now the next number is also 1, so there is a hit. Okay, now the next one is also 1 is there, so there is a hit. There 3, 5, 1 and 7, hit. Now the next number is 7, so 7 is also there, so there is a hit. 3, 5, 1 and 7, hit. Now the next number is 2, so 2 is not there, so find out the number which is least recently used. So 7 is recently used, 1 is recently used, and 3 is also recently used, and the 5th number is the least recently, so that's why I am replacing 5 with 2. So this is 3, 2, 1 and 7, and there is a miss. Now the next number is 3, so for 3 there is a hit. 3, 2, 1 and 7, there is a hit. Now the next number is 4, so 4 is not there. So 3 is recently used, 2 is recently used, and 7 is also recently used. 1 is the number which is least recently used. So that's why I'm replacing 3, 2 and 4 and 7. I'm going to replace this one, and there is a miss. Now the next number is 1. So obviously there is a miss. So I'm just writing the star. Now count the number of stars. Now stars represent the number of faults. Now the number of faults is equal to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12 and 13. So 13 is the correct answer, and 13 is not in the option. So that's why all the options are incorrect. The correct option is 13 only. Okay. Now question number 38. Consider a system having m resources of same type. These resources are shared by three processes, P1, P2, P3, with have peak demands of 257 resources. For what value of m deadlock will not going to be occur? So P1, P2 and P3, three processes are here. Now peak demands are like 2, 5 and 7. So in this case, the minimum you can give it to all the resources are, if there is a peak demand is 2, so I am giving one resource to this process P1, and if the peak demand of P2 is 5, so I am giving the minimum resources 4, and the peak demand of P3 is 7, so I am giving 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 6 resource. So one resource for this person, for this process, 4 resource for this and 6 resource for this. Okay, now so I have to give
you can say the complete resource to one process, so that one process will complete its execution and release their resources to be used by another. Okay, so I'm giving the full resource to this person, to this process. So this process will contain now two resources, and when the execution of this process will going to be complete, so it will release their two resources, right? Now, so this process resource is also satisfied, and after completion of this, it will give the resources to this process, and all the, you know, all the process get their resources, and execution will be complete, and there is no deadlock in this situation. So they are asking that for what value of M deadlock will not going to be occur. So they are asking that minimum number of resources be required. Minimum se minimum, how many resources we required so that deadlock will not going to be occur. So in this type of questions, jahan par aapko minimum number of resources aapse puchhe hue hain, to us case mein aap kya karoge? Ki if there is n processes, agar aapke pas n processes hain, to unme se ek process ko aap kya karoge? Ki complete resources ko प्रोवाइड करवाओगे, एंड जो n माइनस वन होंगे उन्हें जितनी उनकी पीक डिमांड्स हैं उनसे एक कम यू हैव टू प्रोवाइड, एंड जब भी उस प्रोसेस का कंप्लीशन होगा, दैट प्रोसेस इज गोइंग टू बी कंप्लीट, देन वो अपने रिसोर्सेज को रिलीज कर देगी और जो बाकी रिसोर्सेज हैं उनको फुलफिल कर देगी, राइट? जैसे मैंने इस क्वेश्चन में किया कि द पीक डिमांड्स इज 257, P1 की डिमांड इज 2, P2 demand is 5 and P3 demand is 7. So I am giving the minimum number of resources because मुझे minimum number of resources provide करने हैं. So मैंने इसको 4 दिया, इसको 6 दिया. Minimum इसे हमें इतना देना पड़ेगा. And इसका minimum मैंने एक process को मुझे complete करना है. तो मैंने इसको 2 resources उसकी peak demand provide करवाई. So that ये complete हो जाए, ये इस process के resources complete हो जाए. And after the completion of this process, this process is going to be release their resources and give it to this process, and this process you know, resources all satisfied, and this was this process also completed, and then give it to this process. So in this case, deadlock will not going to be occur, and in this situation we are using the minimum number of resources, right? Now, so minimum is 6 plus 4 is 10, 10 plus 2 is 12 number of resources we are going to be used, so that deadlock will not going to be occur. Now see, so first is 70. So minimum hamare 12 resources to hone hi chahiye, usse zyada agar honge that will be okay, that will be fine. Okay, so we have no problem with that. So first is the right option. Now the second one is 14. Yes, 14 is greater than 14, so 14 bhi ho sakta hai, us case mein bhi deadlock nahi hoga. 13 is also you know, greater than 12. So this is also right option, but 7 resources nahi ho sakta, because 7 resources hain, processes ki peak demands itni hai, to deadlock hoga hi hoga. So you can say that option 1, 2 and 3 all are correct. Okay. Now question number 39 is, 5 jobs A, B, C, D, E are waiting in a ready queue. Their expected run times are 9, 6, 3, 5 and X. Okay. So these are processes A, B, C, D and E. All jobs are entered in a ready queue at the time 0, matlab arrival time of all the jobs are same, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0. Okay, and the burst time, the expected run time is 9, 6, 3, and 5, and X. Now you can find the value of X from here. Now X should be greater than 3 and less than 5, and you know that the burst time is shouldn't be in integer, it should not be in a floating point number, so the number is only left is 4. So the X value is 4 now, and you know that actually this kind of statement is just for the confusion purpose only, right? Now, we have to find the minimum average response time. So, minimum average response time. You know that shortest job first algorithm will give us the minimum waiting time. And the minimum waiting time, the waiting time is directly proportional to the response time. So, if this algorithm give us a minimum waiting time, then it should also give us the minimum response time. This is what we want, right? So we are using shortest job first algorithm in this case. Okay, now in the shortest job first, we are choosing those processes those have less burst time. So first process which come in the queue is C, because process C, shortest job first algorithm based on the less burst time. So those process have less burst time come first in the queue. So C is the process which has less burst time. So C come first. Then the next process is E. So E is the next process which come in the queue. Now the next process is D. So D come in the queue. Now the next process is B. So B come and then A come. So what is the order to minimize the average response time is? So order is C, E, D, B, A. So option second is the right one. Okay. So in this question, you have to, you know, remember one thing, that shortest job first is the algorithm which will give us the minimum waiting time. And if it gives us a minimum waiting time, then waiting time is directly proportional to the response time. So it will also give us the minimum average response time. And you know that job, the shortest job first, basically depend, is you can say that it's working on the those process who has less burst time will come first in the queue, or you can say will first execute, then next process will come according to the less burst time. Okay, so this is the whole procedure to solve this question. Now question number 40 is, consider three CPU intensive processes P1, P2, P3 which requires 20, 10 and 30 units of time. Arrival time is 1, 3 and 7. Suppose operating system is implementing shortest remaining time first. So this is also in the SJF we have already studied this algorithm SJF. So SJF is basically a non-primitive algorithm. It's based on those process has a less burst time will come first, right? So what about this shortest remaining time first algorithm? So it's also based on the less those process who has less burst time will come first, but this is a primitive algorithm. So we primed the algorithm, we primed the process in the queue. Okay, now so they said that we are using this algorithm. The contest switching are occurred during the ready queue is how many? So first I will tell you what is context switching, then we will come back to our question. So context switching kya hota hai, I'm writing here. So context switching is saving the content of one process, saving the content of one process and loading the content of another process is called context switching. Like process P1 is there, and now we save the content of P1 and we load P2 here. Okay, so we load P2. So here we are doing context switching, saving the content of one process and loading the another one. Okay, now so we are applying this algorithm. So process are process P1, P2 and P3. Arrival times are it is already given that 137 are the arrival time and the burst time is BT is 20, 10 and 30, and you have to tell the only the context switching between the reticule. So first process is CPU time is 0, but no process comes in this time, so now the CPU is going to be idle from 0 to 1. Now at one time the arrival time is 1 for process P1. Now P1 will come and execute till the next process will come. So the next process will come when the arrival time is 3. So up to 3 it will this process will run, and at time 10, because at time 3 P2 will come because the burst time is less than from this process, right? So this is going to be 17, and you know that 17 and 10, the less burst time is 10, and shortest remaining time for cell algorithm based on the less burst time, those process who has less burst time will come and run in the ready queue. So P2 now come, okay, and it will run completely because among these three processes P2 has less burst time. So 3 plus 10 is 13, so it will run completely. Now among 17 and 13, which process has less burst time? P1 has less burst time, so it will run completely. So P1 is here, so 13 plus 17 is equal to 31, right? So now this process is also complete. Now P3 will come, so 30 plus 31 is 61. Now you have to tell the context switching, but they are saying that suppose context switching at the beginning of the ready queue and the end of the ready queue are not counted, so aapko unko count nahi karna. So between the ready queue you have to count it. So there is one context switching between P1 and P2. We are saving the content of P1 and we are loading P2. Now we are saving the content of P2 and we are loading P1. And then we are saving the content of P1 and we are loading P3. So number of context switching is equal to 3. So option 1 is the right one. Now question number 41 is, which of the following is used to determine the specificity of requirements? So where n is the number of requirements for which all the reviewers have identical interpretations, right? All the reviewers, those who reviews the requirements, they have identical interpretations, okay? And n2 is the number of requirements in the specifications, okay? So n1 is the number of requirements for which jitne bhi reviewers hain unki same interpretation rahe for the requirements ke liye. N1 denotes this, and n2 is the number of requirements, total number of requirements in the specification. So if we talk about the specificity, so basically specificity is just a metric for specification of a quality of a product. And if we talk about the specificity, so that will be equal to NUR divided by me NR, okay, where NUR is the number of requirements for which all reviewers have identical interpretations divided by the number of total number of requirements in the specifications. So this is equal to N1 divided by me N2. So specificity of requirements is equal to N1 divided by me N2. So option A is the right one, okay? Now question number 42 is, the major shortcoming of waterfall model is what?
First one is the difficulty in accommodating changes after requirement analysis. Second one is the difficulty in accommodating changes after feasibility analysis. Third one is system testing, and the fourth one is maintenance of system. Let's talk about the waterfall model first, and then we will discuss about the drawbacks of what waterfall model, and then we will come back to the question. So you know that the waterfall model is a linear sequential model. Why it's a linear sequential model? Basically, in this model, we used to develop the complete operational product at a time. Okay, it's not in different phases. So we are going to complete the product. We are going to complete the whole product at once. The whole product at once. Okay. And this is possible when two things is going to be happen, when the schedule is long, schedule for project, for the completion of project is long, and the second thing is requirements are clear in early phases. So in the waterfall model, it's a linear sequential model, means at one time, ek hi bari mein, it completes the whole product. So it's not, you know, divided into different phases. Ki first maine agar koi car ko manufacture karna hai to pehle hum tires bana rahe hain, then uski body bana rahe hain, fir assemble kar rahe hain. So this kind of thing is not possible in the waterfall model. So complete product is, you know, going to be finish at once. एंड ये चीज़ तभी पॉसिबल है जब टू पॉसिबल केसेस है. एक तो कि स्केड्यूल बहुत लॉन्ग होना चाहिए, कि आपके पास बहुत टाइम है, कि एवरीवन इज़ यू नो गोइंग टू बी एंगेज टू कंप्लीट वन प्रोडक्ट. सो स्केड्यूल उसके लिए बहुत ज़्यादा टाइम चाहिए. एंड द सेकेंड थिंग इज़ रिक्वायरमेंट्स आर क्लियर इन अर्ली फेजेस, कि जब हम मैन्युफैक्चर करने से पहले हमें सारी रिक्वायरमेंट्स का पता होना चाहिए कि हमें क्या 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 चीज़ें चाहिए हैं टू कम्प्लीट द होल प्रोडक्ट. Right, so these two, you know, conditions, or you can say these two drawbacks also, this is also the drawbacks also, because pehle se hi sari requirements ka pata hona, it's very tedious job, right? So now come back to the question. So the major shortcoming of the waterfall model is the difficulty in accommodating changes after requirement analysis. Kyunki अर्ली फेजेस में ही हम रिक्वायरमेंट की एनालिसिस कर लेते हैं वाटरफॉल मॉडल के अंदर, तो उसके बाद इन बिटवीन अगर हमें कोई चेंजेस चाहिए तो इट्स नॉट पॉसिबल, क्योंकि हमने पहले से ही रिक्वायरमेंट एनालिसिस किया, फिर हमने उसकी डॉक्यूमेंटेशन कर दी, तो इट्स वेरी, यू नो, इट्स वेरी डिफिकल्ट टू अकोमोडेट एनी चेंज इन दिस मॉडल. सो दिस इज़ द मेजर शॉर्टकमिंग ऑफ वाटरफॉल मॉडल्स. ओके, now question number 43 is the quick design of a software that is visible to end user leads to iterative model, prototype model, spiral model, or waterfall model. The answer is prototype model. Right? Why? Because what prototype model is a working model when requirements are not clear. In the waterfall model, you have just seen that we used waterfall model where requirements are clear in early phases, but we use prototype model where when requirements are not clear. Okay, so in this prototype model, the framework is like this. So first, the developer team listen to customer. What are the needs of a customer? Okay. Now, so according to the discussion, they prepare a very quick SRS documentation, and they quick design the product and test it, and testing is done by the team. Now then a sample product is, you know, sample product is prepared. Then this sample product basically going for customer evaluation, right? Now according to the feedback they give, whether they give good feedback or whether they give a bad feedback, or you can say positive or negative feedback. So according to the positive feedback, if they give for positive feedback, so they are not going to listen anything, and this sample product is going to be final. And if they give negative feedback, then they again listen to the customer, then they take some advices, then they prepare SRS document, then they design it, test it, and again give the, you can say, product, sample product to the customer evaluation, so that they give feedback, and this feedback basically contains new requirements when SRS document modify accordingly. So you can say that it is an iterative process and it will continue until the customer will going to be satisfied, right? So the correct answer is prototype model. Like, it is a quick design of a software that is visible to the end users. Yes, this is visible to the end users so that they will take the feedback from the customers. Okay, now question number 44 is, for a program of k variables, boundary value analysis yields how many number of test cases? Let's discuss about boundary value analysis hota kya hai, then we will discuss how many number of test cases we used in the boundary value analysis. Okay, so before going to the, you know, boundary value analysis, first I'm going to tell you what is functional testing, because functional testing ka hi ek type hota hai boundary value analysis. So functional testing kya hota hai ki, In the functional testing, we allow to test the functionality of the program. We are doing the testing of the functionality of the program. How we test the functionality of the program? Let's suppose this is a program. So we are giving some input to this program, right? And this is the output. So we, according to the expected output, we are going to match this this output. Okay, so this functional testing, we also known as black box testing. You also heard this type of testing. So black box testing is a functional testing. So black box testing means this is a black box. So we are not concerned about the code, whatever is written in this program. We are just concerned ki hum kya isme input de rahe hain aur kya hamara output aa raha hai. To hum apne expected output se or you can say desired output se hum is output ko match kar rahe hain. To according to that hum uski functionality ko test kar rahe hain. So this is the functional testing, aur ise hum black box testing bhi kehte hain, right? So is functional testing ke different types hain, right? Functional testing has different types, like boundary value analysis, BVA. This is a short form. Next one is robustness testing, equivalence testing, or there is one more, is the worst case testing. Okay, now our target is to study about this boundary value analysis. A boundary value analysis kya hota hai? Boundary value analysis basically, this is also part of the functional testing. So in the boundary value analysis, I'm just writing here, boundary value analysis based on the fact that input values, this is important, input values near to the boundary values have higher chances of error. Okay, so it means that when we do testing with the help of BVA, boundary value analysis, so BVA basically focus on, if we have a variable, let's suppose we have a variable x, and this is a variable, or its range kya hai? 1 to 10. This is the range of this variable, right? So is case mein boundary values kya hai? Minimum value hai, boundary value hai 1, aur maximum boundary value hai 10. Okay, so jo test cases develop honge boundary values ke aas paas, or you can say at the boundary values, un values ke liye there is a high probability of errors. This is the meaning of BVA, aur BVA ki assumption leke chalta. This is the basic assumptions of BVA. You can see this is the basic assumptions of BVA, right? So jo values lie karengi boundary values ke upar, un values ke liye there is a high probability of errors. Okay, now for each variable, like let's suppose for x, right, we have 5 different values against we build the test cases. So 5 values kya hai for each variable, I'm writing here, for each variable 5 different values to build test cases. So 5 values are minimum plus, next value is nominal, then fourth one is max minus and max plus. I'm going to tell you ye values hain kya. Let's suppose we are talking about this variable x. So in this case minimum boundary value is 1, and mean plus value is matlab 1 se thoda sa zyada, thodi si zyada value kya ho sakti hai, maybe it may be 2, am I right? Okay, now the next is nominal value is any normal value between you can say between 2, not a boundary value, beech uske beech mein koi bhi value, nominal value ho sakti hai. Now the max minus value is maximum boundary value se thoda sa kam. Let's take 9, and the max value is 10. Now this is about one variable. Let's suppose we have two variables x and y. X and y two variables, or inki jo range hai wo hai 100 se 300 between. So you know that the boundary values is 100 and the 300, right? Now there is a single fault assumptions is there. Single fault assumption kya kehti hai ki at one time only one variable can take their extreme boundary values. So you know that these are the extreme boundary values, this min max and this max minus and max plus, right? So at one time only one variable can take their extreme boundary values, or remaining jo variable hoga we assign the nominal value to that variable. Jaise ki hamare pas two cases ban sakte hain in this case. So एक वेरिएबल को हम एक्सट्रीम बाउंड्री वैल्यूज अलोकेट करेंगे और दूसरे को क्या करेंगे सिर्फ नॉमिनल वैल्यूज. सो द बाउंड्री वैल्यू इज फर्स्ट इज 100 और नॉमिनल वैल्यू क्या होगी उसके बीच में कोई भी वैल्यू, लेट्स सपोज 200, राइट? नाउ दिस इज मिनिमम, है ना, मिनिमम इस केस में क्या है 100. नाउ द दिस इज फॉर एक्स एंड दिस इज फॉर वाई. नाउ द we are providing the extreme values to one variable. Now the next extreme boundary value is min plus, matlab 100 से थोड़ा सा ज़्यादा, तो 101 is also extreme, we are considering this is also a boundary value, थोड़ा सा ज़्यादा, and दूसरे variable को हम क्या कर रहे हैं सिर्फ nominal value ही provide कर रहे हैं. So this is second test case. Now the third case is nominal. So we are providing nominal to another variable, so I'm not going to provide nominal to this value because we are only giving the extreme boundary values. So extreme boundary values में max minus भी आता है कि अगर 300 एक boundary value है तो इससे थोड़ा सा कम, मतलब 299 value we are going to x, और y को हम क्या दे रहे हैं nominal value, और next extreme boundary value क्या हो जाती है maximum, तो maximum क्या है 300 और nominal value क्या है 200. इन द सेम वे हम ये भी कह सकते हैं कि हम एक्स को नॉमिनल वैल्यू प्रोवाइड कर रहे हैं और वाई को क्या कर रहे हैं, एक्सट्रीम बाउंड्री वैल्यूज प्रोवाइड कर रहे हैं. तो हम सो वी ऑल्सो राइट लाइक दिस, 200 नॉमिनल वैल्यू, एक्सट्रीम बाउंड्री वैल्यू, नॉमिनल एक्सट्रीम बाउंड्री वैल्यू, नॉमिनल एक्सट्रीम बाउंड्री वैल्यू, नॉमिनल एंड एक्सट्रीम बाउंड्री वैल्यू. सो दीज आर द टेस्ट केसेस विच इज़ पॉसिबल. सो दिस इज वी बिल्ड दिस टेस्ट केसेस अकॉर्डिंग टू द सिंगल फॉल्ट अजम्पशंस. सो दिस इज द अजम्पशन फॉर BVA. और सो सिंगल फॉल्ट अजम्पशन सेज दैट एट वन टाइम only one variable can take extreme boundary value and the rest of remaining variable take nominal value. Okay, remaining variable take nominal value. Okay, so this is the single fault assumptions. Now tell me number of test cases possible in a BVA. Okay, if we have two variables, so humne usse kitne test cases humne build ke 1 2 3 4. Ek to ye possibility thi aur ek ye possibility thi, kyunki single fault assumption kehti hai ki agar hamare paas two variables hai to extreme boundary values hum kitne sirf ek ko hi provide karenge aur dusre ko kya karenge, nominal value provide karenge. So now you tell me BVA के अंदर फॉर ईच वेरिएबल 5 डिफरेंट वैल्यूज हैं, जिसमें से बाउंड्री एक्सट्रीम बाउंड्री वैल्यूज कौन सी हैं, दीज 4, राइट. सो आई एम राइटिंग हियर द नंबर ऑफ टेस्ट केसेस. नंबर ऑफ टेस्ट केसेस फॉर n वेरिएबल्स, राइट, फॉर n वेरिएबल्स. So this will be maximum 4n. Why 4n? Because 4 extreme values are there and plus 1 is for the nominal case, right? So we are giving one nominal case to the remaining variable, and 4n is the number of test cases, extreme boundary values. So this is going to be the number of test cases in the BVA. So if there is a k variable, then you can put k value is there. So this is 4k plus 1. So option 3rd is the right one. Okay, starting mein aapko thoda confusing lagega, but this is very easy. Boundary value analysis basically it's a type of functional testing. Functional testing kuch nahi hai, it's a black box testing. दो तरह की टेस्टिंग होती है, एक ब्लैक बॉक्स टेस्टिंग होती है और एक वाइट बॉक्स टेस्टिंग होती है. ब्लैक बॉक्स टेस्टिंग में वी आर नॉट कंसिडरिंग कि क्या कोड है, कैसे इंप्लीमेंट हुआ है, नथिंग. वी आर जस्ट गिविंग सम इनपुट एंड वी आर वेटिंग फॉर द आउटपुट, और उसे हम अपने डिजायर आउटपुट के साथ मैच करवाते हैं, राइट. सो उसकी फंक्शनैलिटी को हम ऐसे जज करते हैं. अब हमें टेस्ट केसेस बनाने हैं, तो टेस्ट केसेस बनाने के लिए वी हैव डिफरेंट टाइप्स ऑफ फंक्शनल टेस्टिंग, जिसमें से एक टाइप है BVA. अब BVA क्या है, एक बाउंड्री वैल्यू एनालिसिस. जैसे कि नाम सजेस्ट कर रहा है, बाउंड्री वैल्यूज़ को हम एनालाइज कर रहे हैं. तो बाउंड्री वैल्यूज़ को एनालिसिस करके हम उनके क्या बना रहे हैं, टेस्ट केसेस. अब टेस्ट केसेस हम कैसे बना रहे हैं कि हमारे पास 5 वैल्यूज़ होती हैं, राइट. फॉर ईच वेरिएबल वी हैव 5 डिफरेंट वैल्यूज़. उसमें से 4 वैल्यूज़ ऐसी हैं जो कि एक्सट्रीम बाउंड्री वैल्यूज़ है, और इसमें से एक वैल्यू है जो कि नॉमिनल है. इफ़ वी टॉक अबाउट 2 वेरिएबल्स, तो उनमें से एक वेरिएबल को तो हम एक्सट्रीम वैल्यूज, एक्सट्रीम बाउंड्री वैल्यूज को एलोकेट कर रहे हैं फॉर ईच नॉमिनल वैल्यू. एक को नॉमिनल वैल्यू, बाकियों को एक्सट्रीम बाउंड्री वैल्यूज. तो दैट्स वाई अगर हम बात करें नंबर ऑफ टेस्ट केसेस जो BVA में बनते हैं, दैट विल बी इक्वल टू 4k. 4k मीन्स 4 एक्सट्रीम बाउंड्री वैल्यूज प्लस दिस आर द नंबर ऑफ वेरिएबल्स प्लस 1 फॉर द नॉमिनल वैल्यू. सो दैट्स वाई द आंसर इज 4k plus 1, राइट. नाउ क्वेश्चन नंबर 45 इज द एक्सटेंट टू विच अ सॉफ्टवेयर परफॉर्म्स इट्स इंटेंडेड फंक्शंस विदाउट फेलियर इज टर्म्ड एज रोबस्टनेस, करेक्टनेस, रिलायबिलिटी और एक्यूरेसी. नाउ लेट्स टॉक अबाउट रोबस्टनेस फर्स्ट. रोबस्टनेस होती क्या है? बेसिकली रोबस्टनेस एक ऐसी एबिलिटी है, इज द एबिलिटी ऑफ अ कंप्यूटर सिस्टम टू कॉप अप विद द एरर्स ड्यूरिंग द एग्जीक्यूशन. जब वो आपका जो सिस्टम है वो एग्जीक्यूट करवा रहा है, तो उसके बीच में जो आपके एरर्स आ रहे हैं तो वो उसको कैसे डील करता है, दिस थिंग विल टेल इन द रोबस्टनेस. ओके, नाउ करेक्टनेस इज बेसिकली यू कैन से दैट व्हेन करेक्टनेस इज सेट व्हेन एल्गोरिथम इज करेक्ट विद रिस्पेक्ट टू द योर स्पेसिफिकेशंस, राइट. सो उसे हम करेक्टनेस कहते हैं. रिलायबिलिटी क्या होता है? रिलायबिलिटी बेसिकली एक प्रोबेबिलिटी ऑफ फेलियर फ्री ऑपरेशंस ऑफ अ सिस्टम ओवर अ स्पेसिफाइड टाइम, स्पेसिफाइड इन्वायरमेंट और स्पेसिफाइड पर्पस, राइट. सो इन द क्वेश्चन दे आर सेइंग दैट द एक्सटेंट टू विच अ सॉफ्टवेयर परफॉर्म इट्स इंटेंडेड फंक्शंस विदाउट फेलियर. सो इट मीन्स दैट दे आर नॉट टॉकिंग अबाउट how well your system cope up with the errors. They are saying that कि बिना failure हुए वो software कैसे perform करता है, this will tell by the reliability. So reliability क्या कहते हैं कि reliability is the probability of a failure free operations of a system over a specified time, environment and for a specified purpose. So answer is third, reliability. Question number 46 is an attacker sites between the sender and receiver captures the information and retransmit to the receiver after some time without altering the information. This attack is called as, first one is denial of service attack. Ab denial of service attack hota kya hai? Basically denial of service is when someone attack the server with malicious packet to take the system, to take that particular system or server down. Let's suppose this is the sender and this is receiver, and in between the network there is some attacker. So attacker in this situation wo kya karega ki attacker will sender is going to send the packet to the receiver. तो इन दिस केस अटैकर स्टोर करेगा ऑल द पैकेट्स को. लेट सपोज दिस इज़ द बॉक्स फॉर अटैकर, एंड वो क्या करेगा, ये जो सारे जो पैकेट्स हैं वो उन्हें यहाँ स्टोर करेगा. एंड आफ्टर स्टोरिंग ऑल द पैकेट्स कमिंग फ्रॉम द सेंडर साइड, वो क्या करेगा कि एट वन टाइम एट वंस सारे के सारे पैकेट्स को रिसीवर को सेंड करना स्टार्ट कर देगा विदाउट एनी मॉडिफिकेशन. This point is to be noted. Without any modification, वो इन सारे पैकेट्स को एक साथ उन्हें भेजना शुरू करेगा. तो उस केस में क्या होगा कि हैवी ट्रैफिक हो जाएगा सर्वर के ऊपर, एंड सर्वर इज गोइंग टू बी बिजी विद दिस फेक पैकेट्स कमिंग फ्रॉम द अटैकर साइड. सो इज नॉट एबल टू गेट द प्रॉपर इन्फॉर्मेशन विच इज सेंडिंग बाई द सेंडर. सो दिस काइंड ऑफ अटैक इज डिनाइल ऑफ सर्विस अटैक. इस केस में क्या हुआ कि although attacker ने captures किया information को, yes attacker ने capture किया information को, but उसने change नहीं किया without any modification. So उसने ये सारे packets को send किया but at one time. So उससे क्या हुआ कि heavy flood हो गया network के ऊपर, और server आपको बहुत busy हो गया with this fake packets, and at this time जो useful information sender को receiver को sender से मिलनी थी वो नहीं मिली, right. So this is the denial of service attack. First attack is denial of service attack, and the next one is masquerade attack. Masquerade attack means कि someone gain authorities and authorities access from your fake or stolen passwords. कि आपने किसी ने आपका password को या तो चुरा लिया है, उसे कहीं से पता चल गया. तो अगर आप की mail ID से कोई और किसी और से आपके फ्रेंड से कोई अगर चैट कर रहा है, तो दिस काइंड ऑफ अटैक इज मैस्कुरेड अटैक. कि आपके पासवर्ड के ऊपर अटैक हुआ है, आपकी यू कैन से पासवर्ड्स और यूज़र आईडी उन्हें पता लग गई है. तो अगर कोई और आपकी इन्फॉर्मेशन को गैदर कर रहा है और प्लस चेंज भी कर रहा है, मैस्कुरेड अटैक में वो चेंज भी कर सकता है आपकी इन्फॉर्मेशन को, तो वो उसे आप कहते हैं मैस्कुरेड अटैक. और सिंपल अटैक इज जस्ट अ सिंपल अटैक कि अगर आप अपनी कोई फायरवॉल है उसे आप ब्रेक कर रहे हो, तो जस्ट इज सिंपल अटैक. एंड कॉम्प्लेक्स अटैक इज नथिंग. सो डिनाइल ऑफ सर्विस अटैक अमंग ऑल फोर अटैक्स, डिनाइल ऑफ सर्विस एक ऐसा अटैक है जिसमें वो कैप्चर करता है इन्फॉर्मेशन को पर मॉडिफाई नहीं करता. आफ्टर सम टाइम it you know sent back to the receiver, but with heavy traffic. So option first is the right one.